They're creepy and they're kooky, mysterious and spooky. They're all together ooky, the Rewind family. They live in a computer lab, and Mr. V is like their dad. The 14 girls and 3 lads, the Rewind family. We have Gina squared, Alyssa's 2, double Kate's Bianca Boo. Our 2 redheads are Ash and Mooch, the Rewind family. Christy is a funny gal, our junior Aaron take a bow. And Sam and Amy are best pals, the Rewind family. Dan Rogers is a nice guy, Panza thinks he's real fly. But the rest of us don't know why, the Rewind family. Liv is the head honcho, why CJ in a poncho, while eating lots of nachos, the Rewind family. So here's a show we're proud of, made for you with our love. It's sure to be full of the Rewind family.
Hey Township, what's up? I'm Olivia Devine.
And I'm Sam Baranowski, and we're here with your second edition of Monthly Rewind. Liv, why don't you give us the first segment?
Boo! It's Halloween again. Gina Bonino tells us about the festive day.
Whether you're an angel or a devil, a classic superhero, or even your typical bumblebee, people everywhere are gearing up for Halloween. Every year, people spend hundreds of dollars on the perfect Halloween decorations and costumes. Some costumes are original, some are spooky, and others have been around for ages. Children and adults alike set out every year to find the costumes that suit them the best.
This year for Halloween, I'm wearing a nice blue and yellow little Bo Peep dress with a little garter, matching shoes, and I dress up as basically a 10-year-old girl. And I already have the body frame and the hair for it, so it'll work. It's really, really pretty, actually.
This year for Halloween, my friends and I are dressing as characters from The Wizard of Oz. I'm being the lion, my friend Katie's being the Tin Girl, and my friend Kate is being the Scarecrow.
This year for Halloween, I'm going to be the famous 80s cartoon character, Captain Planet. I don't know if you remember him. Basically, I'm going to paint my entire body silver. I'm going to wear some red softies and do the little symbol and all the other stuff. Do the flat top, spray it green so it looks really cool. I'm stoked. It's going to be amazing.
We all have memories of a favorite costume, or maybe one we've really hated. But it's those Halloween classics that we'll always remember.
I remember being 4 years old and being Casper the Ghost, but I remember that it was one of those cheap, really plasticky kind of outfits, and I never wanted to wear the mask that went with it. So that's probably like my earliest memory of Halloween and being unhappy the whole night.
My favorite Halloween costume that I've ever had was this really sweet dinosaur costume. It was a green with like orange spikes that went down the back, and I had a tail, and there was like a little hole for my face, and I still have it. I mean, if I could wear it, I totally would.
I don't remember it, but when I was 2 or 3 years old, I was a little bunny, and everyone tells me how adorable I was. I don't know. You be the judge. As far as a favorite costume, I remember one year I was the mummy, and this is Boris Karloff, the mummy, so I'm probably dating myself. But it took me over an hour to get into my costume, and also I started to come apart during the course of the night. So it was a great costume, but a little embarrassing at the same time.
Today, more than 93% of children in the United States dress up and venture out on the 31st for one sole purpose, to get the candy. From Snickers to M&M's, the possibilities are endless. My favorite Halloween candy is Reese's because they're awesome.
I like a lot of different Halloween candies, but my favorite would probably have to be 100 grand.
My favorite Halloween candy by far is definitely Skittles.
What? Ew, dude. Ew. It's all about the Starburst.
Skittles are a lot better, dude.
No, it's legitimately not. Skittles. No.
Starbursts are definitely better.
It's legitimately Skittles.
They're individually wrapped.
No.
They're sweet. They're Skittles. Delicious.
You're never too old to dress up for Halloween. Many students continue to roam the halls of WTHS in their favorite Halloween gear. You'd even be surprised to find a couple teachers taking part in the festivities. So whether you plan on dressing up in your favorite costume, carving out a jack-o'-lantern, or trick-or-treating for tons of candy, Halloween will continue to be a popular tradition for many years to come. This has been Gina Benigno reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 12. See you next month.
Breast cancer is one of the most common diseases found in women. Kristen Mucci tells us how Township is giving back to a worthy cause.
One in a seven women will develop breast cancer in their lifetime. There's approximately 3 million women living in the U.S. with breast cancer. Only 2 million of them are diagnosed. Someone is diagnosed with breast cancer every 3 minutes. Every 14 minutes, another life is lost in the battle against breast cancer. These are the chilling statistics of breast cancer on a national level. Locally, students here at WTHS have taken part in various activities promoting breast cancer awareness. Their involvement is meant to impact the statistics so that in the future, no one goes undiagnosed. The month of October is known as Breast Cancer Awareness Month. As a community, we have participated in many activities such as painting the town pink, selling breast cancer ribbons, and raising money for breast cancer walks. When supporting a cause as widespread as breast cancer, there is no doubt many emotions can be felt by its participants.
I think it's wonderful because many people are affected and know someone with breast cancer, and I think it hits home for a lot of people and they can relate to it and also take it seriously.
I think I feel really good that I helped raise money for research and helping maybe save somebody's life. I mean, my whole group raised over $800, and that's a lot of money to contribute to one little thing.
My participation in breast cancer awareness makes me feel great because I'm not only helping one person, but I'm helping millions of people around the world who are diagnosed with breast cancer.
Promoting breast cancer awareness can be a very rewarding experience. A lot can be learned from actively supporting a cause you feel strongly about.
I have learned how important it is to take it seriously at a young age because, I mean, it can affect anyone, and at any age it doesn't, you know, there's no criteria for it. It can hit anyone at any age, and it's so important to just get checked because it affects so many people.
One thing I've taken away from participating in breast cancer awareness is buying something as small as a pink ribbon can mean saving someone's life.
Breast cancer is a leading cause of cancer death in women. Your support can make a difference in the lives of those affected by breast cancer.
Try to get involved, basically. You can go on the internet. I mean, there's all kinds of information that you can find. Even if you don't want to get involved, like go to a walk or anything like that, there's always places that you can contribute money to. Like I said, every dollar counts.
Everyone should get out there and get involved with breast cancer awareness because it's a really rewarding experience helping people who are in need.
I would tell them how important it is at a young age too, not because necessarily just for themselves, but I think the older generations aren't quite as aware, and we can teach them, especially at their age, that they need to be.
Breast cancer affects many lives throughout the nation and our community. To its participants, it can be a very emotional yet very rewarding experience. So I urge you, your family members, and your friends to get out there and do your part in promoting breast cancer awareness. This has been Kristen Mucci reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 12.
Need help getting a date? Chris Penz is here with some helpful tips.
Dances, proms, games, or even just nights on the town. There are many reasons why a guy might want a date in township, but finding a date can sometimes be as hard as finding a four-leaf clover. But there's a four-leaf clover out there for everybody. You just have to know how to look for it. You will never need dating books, surveys, or any other dating gimmicks to find a date anymore. So get up and find out what girls really look for in a guy.
What I look for in a guy is a guy that knows how to make a girl laugh, can treat a lady good, can make someone feel better when they're not feeling good, and someone that you could trust, because if you can't trust anyone, then you have nothing.
First, I look for a presentable appearance, and then after that, I'll do the personality. They have to be respectful, polite to my parents, have to make me laugh, kind, just a fun person to be around.
You always have to come up with like fun things to do. You guys don't want to sit in all the time. You have to like always care about me if I'm upset. Like, it's important that the person can make me feel better.
Different girls look for different qualities in guys, but all of them have the same basic structure of what they think the perfect guy is. This chart will generalize what all girls basically look for in a guy. Out of a poll taken of 72 girls about what qualities they think are most important in a guy, 30% said sense of humor, 22% said charm, 11% said presentable appearance, 22% said honesty, 6% said intelligence, 3% said polite, and 6% said successful. Now that we know the basics of what a girl looks for in a guy, let's find some different ways in which a guy can ask a girl out on a date. Games and nights on the town are more casual dates and don't require anything more than a simple request to be someone's date. But proms and dances are probably the most stressful events to find a date for. But there are many creative ways you can ask a girl to be your date.
This kid had roses leading to my doorstep with a note on the door and it said, turn around. I turned around. He was right there. He asked me if I would go to prom with him. And I said, yeah.
I was sitting under the fireworks with my friend when he asked me to go to prom with him.
And there you have it. All you need to know about how to find a date. You now know the basics of what a girl looks for in a guy and some different ways in which you could ask a girl to be your date. Now the rest is up to you. To use what I gave you and get out there and find a date for yourself. And that's the way the cookie crumbles. Thank you. This has been Chris Penza reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 12.
Guten Tag. Yes, I did just speak in German. Ash Levins is here to tell us about the German language program.
Du bist immer spät zur Klasse. Was ist dein Problem? Wir haben einen Prüfung heute.
Some of you may wonder, why would I ever be interested in studying German? Well, I'm here to tell you, it's a lot more than just a weird language where people spit a lot. In today's competitive market, it's extremely important for students to have a special skill. Mastering German will make these students more marketable and set them apart from the competition.
I think what really makes our German program and our students very special is the fact that we have kids that are so interested in the language, the culture, and interested in the history of German-speaking countries. The kids and the parents really know that, or the students and the parents know how special German is.
As a teacher at the university level, Mr. A has seen firsthand how students with a mastery of the German language have an advantage over others when it comes to admissions and scholarships.
I think that our students really enjoy having the interactive nature in our classrooms. It's not always me standing there talking, where it's students that are actually interacting with one another, where someone may say something and someone else feels free to join in and have a conversation. But I also, one thing that I always think is very noticeable or noteworthy is the fact that our students can really hold a conversation. They know colloquial terms. They know terminology that other students in other languages may not be exposed to. Why is that? Words come up in class during our free conversations. And I think that helps to keep the kids interested and on task.
The German program at WTHS offers students the chance to learn in ways other than just grammar and writing. These opportunities give students firsthand experiences that could never be copied in a classroom.
This is a really great opportunity for us to learn about German culture and what happens in Germany, because usually in class we only speak German and you don't get that much of an opportunity to, you know, dance and sing and eat what they do over there.
I really like these activities like Oktoberfest and Sprachfest and the other German things that we do, because it's a way for all of us that study the same culture to just come together and hang out. I mean, we can all eat, drink, and dance together, and we're just one big happy Deutsch family.
In German class, it's a lot of oral stuff and a lot of writing and a lot of reading, but in Oktoberfest, you get to learn about all the cultural kind of foods and activities that take place in a real Oktoberfest. And you get to meet a lot of people from other schools, and it's a fun time.
Germany is located in the heart of Europe, but these events are celebrated worldwide. However, some of you may wonder if these celebrations in America are just as much fun and traditional as those in Germany.
I'm an exchange student from Germany, and the differences between the German Oktoberfest and the US Oktoberfest are not that big. In Germany, the main colors of Oktoberfest are white and light blue. And when we were with the German class at the Kornschwald High School, the colors were black, red, and yellow, so it's kind of different. The most people who celebrate the Oktoberfest in Germany are adults, because they mainly drink beer and eat pretzels and sauerkraut and some kind of meat. And the food at the Kornschwald High School was like very good. It was very authentic. They had pretzels and sauerkraut and beans and stuff, so it was very good. And they had music, they had like a marching band. That's the real music they play at the Oktoberfest. They have like trumpets and trombones. It's like marching music. That's really funny, and it was like very good. And I think that the people who would go to Kornschwald High School Oktoberfest and visited before the German Oktoberfest would think that's very good.
The German language has a lot more to it than just sentence and oral structure. Exposure to its rich cultural heritage makes this difficult language a lot easier to grasp. It is one of the top spoken languages worldwide, and anyone who is fluent in it will be a valuable asset in today's ever-changing global marketplace. This has been Ashley Levins reporting from Monthly Rewind, Season 12.
Auf Wiedersehen.
On October 27th, Township held one of its biggest events here at Township, the Spirit Parade and Homecoming. Christy Garcia gives us the inside scoop on the big event.
This October, a big high school tradition is on the minds of all of the WTHS students, homecoming. And as the class of 08 becomes seniors, they get the chance to start off the new school year with a bang. With the senior kickoff, holla back, and homecoming dances, the football game, and the seniors' election of the homecoming court, all grades were able to share in the big start to the hopefully eventful new year. Starting off the festivities was the annual senior kickoff dance held in Quay Way. The homecoming court was introduced to the senior class in the company of their escorts, but that was just the beginning of their hectic preparation. The girls felt overwhelmed but excited about their experience in the court.
It's a lot of fun to be in court, and it's a huge honor, but at the same time, like, there was just so much going on with escorts and making shirts and the dance rehearsals and just getting everything done. It's so much fun, I'm so excited, and besides all the busyness, it's definitely all worth it.
Well, we had to make posters for ourselves that our flower boys will carry out in front of us, and it's been fun, it's been a lot of fun doing that. Some of the girls got t-shirts made and pins made, so that was a process, I'm sure, for them. Preparing for the dance that we did at the dance and at the Spirit Parade, which you'll all get to see. And that's been hard for me because I'm terrible at that. So it's been such a good time. It's been overwhelming, but overwhelming with excitement, so.
They're announced so many times. They're announced at senior kickoff. Well, they're announced at school first, then at senior kickoff. They walk around the school the day of, you know, they're announced at the game. So I thought maybe a little something different for the night of the homecoming dance, if it would be nice if they did a dance with their escorts. And I thought they would laugh at me when I asked them to do this, but they were such a great group of girls. They just embraced the idea, and without question, they practiced and they learned the dance. So I was really, really pleased with this group of girls.
With the addition of the dance to the homecoming tradition, the girls were able to show off their talents in a group dance. Despite the unease surrounding the new event, the students thought the dance was a big hit.
But I did have fun. They threw up a good dance, and I liked it.
Thought it was going to be really lame because it was in the gym, but it wasn't that bad, and it looked good.
It was good, and there were a lot of people, though. There were really a lot of people, and I was, like, dying. It was so hot. But it was good.
The homecoming game followed the night after, opening with the Spirit Parade. WTHS's numerous clubs and activities were represented preceding the game. With Cherokee playing the Minutemen on that Saturday, the coaches pushed the players to excel on the big night.
And we've been staying late after practice, the first team, offense and defense, watching film and stuff. We spent extra time out there. Even though it's raining, we're doing everything we can to get ready for the game.
And all of their hard work paid off. The boys beat Cherokee with a score of 24-14. At halftime, the climax of the weekend built as the homecoming court was escorted onto the track. Finally, Jess Mannon was announced as homecoming queen, and the girls couldn't have been happier.
We're all really excited that Jess won. She's a wonderful person. She's one of my best friends, and she's always there for me whenever I need her. So I'm so thrilled that she was crowned the 2007 homecoming queen.
Our successful homecoming has set the tone for quite a big year. The seniors ushered in their final year enjoying their homecoming with the underclassmen. This year's festivities will leave a new idea of homecoming that the following classes of WTHS will be able to enjoy for years to come. This has been Christy Garcia reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 12.
The annual Buddy Walk took place in October. Dan Rogers tells us all about it.
On October 7, 2007, the annual Buddy Walk, a one-mile walk and festival supporting Down syndrome, was hosted at Washington Lake Park. It was organized by WTHS's Interact Club, and after many hours in meetings, organizing events, and recruiting volunteers, Interact succeeded in making this year's Buddy Walk highly enjoyable.
We've been involved with the Buddy Walk as long as I've been the advisor, and they were in it before I came in. We have had some Down syndrome students in the school, and I think that some of those parents came to the high school and asked for volunteers, and then it just grew from that. On the day of the Buddy Walk, it's a day to celebrate Down syndrome, and so they have a walk, and then they have games, lunch, entertainment, different things like that at the park. And we help them set everything up, we help run all the games, just anything they need us to do.
The Buddy Walk was first created in 1995 by the National Down Syndrome Society to promote National Down Syndrome Awareness Month, and it involves numerous games and activities for everyone who participates.
It always seemed like a fun thing, like I heard about, like everyone just kind of came like with their friends and stuff. You know, it's for a good cause.
I did a Buddy Walk just because it's a real good cause, help out with the community and give a little back to the community.
Down syndrome is a hereditary disorder that occurs as a result of trisomy 21. Which is when someone has three copies of chromosome number 21 instead of two. Because of this additional chromosome, a person's physical and mental development is altered. Down syndrome is the most common occurring abnormality, and there are more than 350,000 people living with Down syndrome in America today.
I have had some students with Down syndrome. I have worked with kids with Down syndrome. And we do have a teacher in the high school whose son has Down syndrome, and so she's involved as well, and she's kind of the liaison between the high school and the Buddy organization.
This year, Interact Executive Board members Nada Hinn and Charles Gaiway were chosen chairs of the Buddy Walk. Nada and Charles were responsible for recruiting and organizing WTHS volunteers, and they helped prepare time slots for running games.
Because this Buddy Walk wouldn't be possible without all the members of Interact working with it. So my job was to one day at least hold a meeting and just get all the jobs out there, make sure everyone knows what they are.
These simple yet effective games and activities in the Buddy Walk played an important part of its success.
Most of the games were prepared by the actual Buddy Walk organization, and they've been using the same games that have become old-time favorites for years. So all these things that were made have been here for a while.
The Buddy Walk is a huge benefactor in raising awareness about Down syndrome, and after careful organization and planning, the Interact Club at WTHS helps make this year's Buddy Walk highly enjoyable. Although Down Syndrome Awareness Month may be over, you can still show your support for Down Syndrome any time of the year. Log on to buddywalk.org to see how you can show your support. For Monthly Rewind, Season 12, I'm Dan Rogers.
Boys soccer is a team to be reckoned with here at Township. TJ Alcorn gives us the 411 on the conference winning champs.
Yeah.
Since 1991, the boys' soccer team has been in a drought. They had not won the conference in 17 years, but this drought is over. This season, the boys have gone on a tear to become Olympic Conference champs. And with their hard work, leadership, and team chemistry, nothing's stopping them now.
They have a lot of experience back from last year, and they're also very talented. So between talent that we have, the athleticism that we have, and the experience that we have, and the leadership that we get from all the seniors, but in particular from the captains, Chris Dunn and Todd Kleinstuber, it's just been a real good experience.
The team is led by senior captains who are like coaches on the field to the rest of the players.
Our team chemistry is pretty good, and just having a successful season is a great thing. After 17 years winning conference, it's just a great feeling.
We played very well all year long. We haven't really had a bad game, and that's what it takes. I mean, they show up every day, and they come to play every day and take our chances, and I like our chances when they show up to play.
It feels pretty good to break that drought and finally win conference.
These guys have been playing together forever, and they're great friends, so they have a lot of fun. But when it comes to crunch time, they know how to focus.
We've had a few team meetings, especially after our first loss against Lumpy. We've had some meetings and got everybody focused, and we know that this is the best year we've had for soccer in a long time. If we screw it up, we'll never get it back. So.
And with states just around the corner, the players only have their mind on one thing.
Well, every team we played in our conference is also in states. They all qualify for states with a 500 record. And since we won our conference, then we can do well, and we think we can come out on top.
The top seed going to the state tournament, I think our chances of getting to the finals are pretty good right now. We just have to stay focused and put the ball in the back of the net.
I like our chances. You never know. It takes a little bit of luck. Play well, we can beat anybody on any given day, and I know we're going to do the best we possibly can, and couldn't ask for anything more.
So with their preparation and practice, the leadership of their captains, and the chemistry that these guys share, they're ready for anything. And being conference champs certainly is a sweet emotion, but now they're only looking for one thing, that state championship. This has been TJ Alcorn reporting from Month 3 Rewind, Season 12.
Here's this month's edition of Monthly Rewind Mail Time with your host, Olivia Devine.
Happy Halloween! Welcome to the second edition of Monthly Rewind Mail Time. I'm your host, Olivia Devine. Why don't we get down to the letter? Dear Monthly Rewind, when are you too old to dress up for Halloween? Sincerely, Dale Beeble. Well, Dale, that is an excellent question, but the answer is simple. You are never too old to dress up for Halloween.
Guys, why don't we have like a little celebration for Halloween, like nothing big, just like some food and stuff.
Okay. All right, Mooch, what are we going to be for Halloween?
I don't know.
How about two jailbirds?
No, let's be a Big Mac and someone eating it. I'm loving it.
I know what we're going to be, Mooch.
I like it.
No one dresses up for Halloween anymore.
This is so embarrassing. I didn't know people didn't dress up.
Me either.
I'm gonna go get changed.
Me too.
Are we still on for trick-or-treating later?
Yeah.
All right, great. I'll see you later.
Dale, I hope that answered your question. No matter what, be true to yourself. And of course, dress up for Halloween. If anyone has a comment or question that they'd like to ask me, please email me at monthly_rewind@yahoo.com. Have a great night, everyone, and tune in next month. I'm Olivia Devine. See you later.
There's more segments to come right after this brief commercial break.
New Orbit Sweetmint for just magic clean feeling, no matter what.
Did you know that one of our very own gym teachers here at Township is known for their martial arts? Katie Jewell is here with this month's teacher feature. Yeah!
When you think of teachers, you automatically expect grades, homework, and boring classes. But there's a lot more to them than you may think. One teacher in particular is Miss Eileen Fassel.
My name is Miss Fassel, and I teach here at Washington Township as a health and physical education teacher.
Miss Fassel has many likes and hobbies, but where did she start off?
I attended Rowan University and graduated in 2001. I started substitute teaching here at Washington Township in the school year 2001-2002. 3 years later, I became a full-time teacher.
In addition to teaching, Ms. Fassel is also the coach of the JV girls tennis team and has been the assistant coach of the track team for the past 3 years.
I really enjoy working with the student athletes, and I try to help them as much as I can.
Ms. Fassel is a really good coach. She's really devoted and puts a lot of time into this, into the team. It's always really fun in practice and games. We always have a good time.
She makes practices fun and gives us pointers in our match when she sees we need them.
And she helps us out a lot because she cheers us on and she gets us really excited.
Not only does Ms. Fassel motivate students on the track and on the courts, but in the classroom as well.
I like Ms. Fassel's class a lot. She's very open about all of our discussions. She makes class interesting by using interactive activities where we all talk about different subjects and us in real world situations and stuff, and I like her a lot.
She's an easygoing teacher, and we can just have our own class discussions, and it's pretty relaxed in our class.
In the classroom, students only get to see one side of Ms. Fassel, but there's a lot more to her than meets the eye.
Some of the things that students may not know about me is that I have competed in the martial arts. I've trained extensively, and in 1993 and 1994, I competed nationally, and I was ranked top 10 in the nation in sparring, weapons, and forms. I have also hiked the Appalachian Trail from North Carolina to Maine, and that is a footpath that goes from Georgia to Maine. I also bicycled across the United States, and I started in Oregon and bicycled back to New Jersey, and it took me 2.5 months. Some of my hobbies are landscaping, photography, love to ski, and I like to read and go to the beach.
So, the next time you look at a teacher, know that there's a lot more to them than just a chalkboard and a lesson plan.
Ms. Fassel plans to stay here as a teacher at Washington Township High School until she retires. But until then, looks like we're stuck with her.
I'll send you to the moon!
Lucky us!
This has been Katie Jewell reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 12.
The annual Pace Setters Dance took place on October 19th. Alyssa Figueroa gives us the inside scoop.
Washington Township High School hosts many dances throughout the school year. However, there is one dance that stands out for making a difference in people's lives. The Fall Pace Setters Dance, a dance held for mentally challenged adults, is one that truly brightens up the night for everyone who participates.
This Interact sponsored event occurred on October 19, 2007, as over 200 mentally challenged adults and Interact members filled Cafeteria CD. The purpose of the dance is to throw a costume party for Halloween so the adults can have a good time and socialize with one another, as well as the Interact members who volunteer to dance with them. However, making this dance a success requires lots of time and preparation. Weeks before the dance, Interact members are busy painting pumpkins, making Halloween decorations, getting the food that will be provided at the dance, and hiring a DJ.
It's really a lot of work, but it's worth it, every second of it. It's the feeling you get, just making people happy. Just even if it's just painting pumpkins, you know that it's decoration for a great event and a great cause. Everybody just has a blast.
They also have to send out invitations to the adults. Invitations are extended to those in group homes as well as those living on their own or with family. The adults are eager to respond.
I have put the invitations in the mail like on a Thursday afternoon. Friday afternoon, they've started calling me on the phone. And I didn't even think they could get the mail that quick.
On the night of the dance, the mentally challenged adults, known as the Pace Setters, and Interact members enthusiastically fill the cafeteria to mingle and dance the night away. It is evident that the dance means a great deal to the Pace Setters.
They don't really have a lot of chances to do a lot, so when they get an opportunity like this where they can go out and dance and have fun, it's a big deal, and they go home and they talk about it for weeks, like this is the biggest night for a while.
Even an assistant director to one of the group homes for the Pace Setters clearly sees the difference it makes to them.
It's healthy for them because they get the attention. By the time they get home, they do have smiles on their faces. So that's how we can tell that they had a good time.
Not only do the Pace Setters have a blast, but the Interact members enjoy themselves as well.
Pace Setters is my favorite event of the year because we get to spend time with the Pace Setters, and they're just really fun people. They love to have fun and dance with us, and I love to have the chance to give them a great time tonight.
I like to make the Pace Setters very happy, and it makes them feel better about themselves knowing that they made someone else's day a lot more enjoyable and a lot of fun.
This meaningful event was made a tradition when the group was established. The group known as the Pace Setters was started 20 years ago by the parents of Kenny Schwartz, a boy with Down syndrome. After Kenny got out of high school, he no longer had social events to participate in. His parents then founded a group consisting of other parents who have mentally challenged children. Kenny comes early to lend a hand every time Interact holds a dance for the Pace Setters. He also enjoys filming, just like us Rewinders.
I come here because I want to help out. I'll be taking videos every month.
At the end of the dance, Kenny was presented with a gift for assisting with the event. The dance was wrapped up as everyone joined hands to celebrate the exciting night they had.
It's always worth putting something on, but it's also very enjoyable to see everything in action and to see the kids interacting with our guests and to see the joy on their faces because they love coming.
Once again, this year's Fall Pacesetters Dance provided a great time for both the Pacesetters and Interact members. This event continues to have a wonderful effect on the Pacesetters as they experience a night out socializing with friends as well as making new ones. This has been Alyssa Figueroa giving you the buzz from Monthly Rewind Season 12.
The marching band is gearing up for many big events. Bianca Beck tells us more.
With a slight decrease over the past few years, the WTHS Marching Band and Color Guard shown that they have really stepped up to the plate. They have been selected to perform at the Outback Bowl in Tampa Bay, Florida, December 29th through January 2nd. The band will perform at halftime with a mass band, and being the only high school selected to play from the East Coast, it's truly an honor.
Well, every year we get invitations to apply to different festivals so all over the country, and so we looked at this particular trip and we thought that it would be rewarding and beneficial for our students, so we applied and were accepted to participate.
This year, in December, we're going to Tampa Bay, Florida, and I'm really excited because I'm going to be with all my friends and it's going to be a lot of fun.
And we've been working so hard, like, people don't even understand, we put in so many hours, like, we have practice Tuesday, Thursday, we do our football games on Friday, we have competition Saturday, some Sundays, like, some football games we even have on Saturday, then we go right to a competition, so it's a lot of work, and then to get a trip, it's like a little bit of a bonus for doing all that hard work.
They are also going to perform at the United States Scholastic Band Association New Jersey State Championships November 3rd here at WTHS, then will move on to the USSBA Northern States Championship at Giant Stadium in East Rutherford, New Jersey on November 10th.
Well, the USSBA State Championships is really one of the first culminating events of the competitive season for a lot of bands, where, you know, usually we start every week going to local shows and then we build up to a state championship show and then we'll go on to an all-state championship show the following week. So all the various states around the area are either having their championships on November 3rd or the week before, leading up to all-state championships. So New Jersey State Championships is a rather large show featuring about 35 bands, and the show is broken down by band size. So the smaller bands will go on earlier in the day, ending with the biggest bands in the state at the end of the day. All in all, the show's probably gonna run close to 10, 11 hours all day, Saturday, November 3rd, from 1 o'clock until about 10:30, 11, with all the bands, and you know, and there'll be champions awarded in six group sizes.
Championships in Giant Stadium is really fun because you're in a stadium, so the sounds are like really loud. You get really nervous because you're in a whole different scenery and it's big and there's a lot of judges walking around.
The band and color guard start rehearsal July 18th and don't conclude until January 2nd, making this program the longest running after school program WTHS has to offer. Even though they may go through rough practices and long rehearsals, they have truly named themselves one of the best. I would really like to wish them good luck in their future competitions and shows. This has been Bianca Beck reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 12.
Burr, it's cold in here. I said there must be ice hockey in the atmosphere. Emily Bennett's here with the 411 on the ice hockey team.
The pressure is on, the expectations are high. Last year's team set the standards, but how do you live up to that? This year's varsity ice hockey team has to step up to the plate to accomplish what they did last year. With the loss of 10 seniors, this year is all about rebuilding.
Under the leadership of head captain Parker Brown and assistant captains Greg Ortiz and Jim Tumo, this season is starting out well. With the record being 1-3, the team faces a tough schedule this year. But how is this year different than last year?
This year is very different from last year. Last year we had high scoring team, and this year pretty much our whole game is we just have to keep it in defense, just get the puck deep pretty much.
We're going to win every game, probably maybe by a goal or two. Last year we were blowing out teams. This year we got to work hard. And
it's a lot different because the leadership and responsibility were like divided up between a lot of the kids, and this year it's just like about four of us.
With the starting lineup consisting of four seniors and two juniors, this year has been based on rebuilding. With the loss of many seniors last year, they've had to regroup and play differently. But what exactly do they need to do differently this year?
This year we're trying to get above 500, get as many wins as we can, and just, you know, keep everyone with high confidence and good morale, and try and get a good fan turnout because hockey games are a lot of fun to watch.
Attentions, at least make it to the playoffs and then work harder from there. We gotta win every game one by one, take it time at time.
With the great success of this team last year, not many people know what they accomplished. So what exactly do they do?
Played Shawnee for the championship last year. We ended up winning 6-7, and we got the trophy and all. Then we went to Flyers Cup and got to the final round, which is not many New Jersey teams do that. So it was a real honor to be in that game.
That was great. It was probably one of the biggest championships I've ever won. It was a great experience, and now I can just use it to play this year.
It's hard to explain. It was very unexplainable. It's something I can't describe, but I remember for the rest of my life.
Playing in the Spectrum was a pretty big experience for, I think, everybody on the team, and just a good way to go out on top. Last year was probably one of the best seasons Township Hockey's ever had.
With this season already in swing, these boys know exactly what they need to do to accomplish what they did last year. With the loss of many key players, this year allows for many players to step up and show what they have. Make sure you come out and support these boys in their home games. This has been Emily Bennett reporting to you from Monthly Rewind Season 12.
Don't touch that remote. Rewind will be right back after this short break.
I like it because it's soft, but not too soft. Buttery, but not too buttery. And I could just sit here and enjoy it all day.
Done!
Colonel? You got a little something.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And here's Gina Torto with our senior feature on the 2007 Homecoming Queen.
When I describe someone who gets along with everyone, volunteers in their spare time, and is a newly crowned homecoming queen, who comes to mind? You should all be thinking of Jessica Mannon. Jess is also an AP student, which normally would be tough, but Jess manages to pull it all together.
It's actually probably the hardest year I've had so far. I have AP biology, which I know nothing about. I sit in there and ask everyone else questions. I have AP psychology, which interests me a lot. I like psychology and studying people's thoughts, and AP statistics. And then I have like my fun classes, like sociology. I have childcare. In gym, we're playing badminton. Killing it at that.
But Jess isn't all brains. She is a senior class officer and a member of the National Honor Society. She also works one night a week and volunteers one night a weekend at the Sensory Playhouse.
The Sensory Playhouse is a place where it's specifically for special needs kids because it's a very personable place. That's what my bosses are known for knowing the families, knowing, you know, everything about them. Class Council is my favorite. It's probably the most involved. It's my favorite because many of my close friends do it. We are in homeroom together every morning. We're after school doing things. Come December, we'll do 24 in the Core, where we raise gifts for children who need presents around Christmas. NHS is a nice one. You have to do community service for that, so it incorporates a lot of good qualities in people.
But when the working day is done, Jess is someone that likes to hang out with her friends and can make you feel immediately comfortable with her.
For as long as I've known Jess, she's been the type of person who you can go up to and tell her anything and automatically feel comfortable and know that she's not judging you for what you're saying.
Jess sticks out in our class as someone who's well-rounded, smart, and involved. Jess has also been one of my best friends for 6 years. She is someone that inspires me to be a better person every day through example. This has been Gina Torto for Monthly Rewind, Season 12. White houses.
What's the true brotherhood in township? Kate Polson tells us all about the township football team.
These boys aren't just part of a team, they are part of what they like to call a brotherhood. Yeah, that's right, township football is closer than ever this year. They bring township pride to a whole nother level.
The team is led by captains Steve Graziano, Michael Schatzman, Dan Hearn, Ramel McGinnis, Quabina Keene, and Dave Haltebrand. These six boys have many duties, but their main ambition is to lead the brotherhood. The members of the team feel these guys do a good job fulfilling their duties.
They have a good leadership. They bring us together and stuff. We have like a lot of team bonding before games. They'll always keep us up like when we're doing bad. They always have a good enthusiasm and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, the captains do a good job because Ramal always says, "I love football," and everyone just goes nuts, and it's pretty fun. I like it.
I think that this year we have some of the best leadership with the captains, with the six captains that we have. I think they just do a great job getting us pumped up for the game, with the speeches that they give us. I mean, I think we have the best leadership in the past few years on the team.
The boys aren't the only ones getting excited for the games. The fans are getting pretty pumped up too. With up to 3,000 people attending these games, they make sure they're there to support their team through win or loss.
With the stadium packed with township fans that miss every game, the students are always there supporting their team through win or loss.
Fans have been great this year. They're at all our away games, all our home games, and it's great hearing them on the field because it really gets us pumped up.
The fans this year, they're really outgoing. They love coming to the games. They're a lot better, I think, than the fans in the previous years, and they really get involved when the cheerleaders do the cheers to the fans.
This year, the fans are really supportive. They're at every game, and they get us really pumped up.
There you have it. From the players to the fans, there's enough township pride to go around. So make sure you become a part of it. Come out and support the football team. This has been Caitlin Paulson reporting to you from Monthly Rewind Season 12.
One club and township is changing the world one moo at a time. Erin Dunphy is here to tell us all about the Cal Project.
In 2003, Eileen Lucarini and Deb Chamberlain created the Cal Project, a place where teens could go and express hopes for diversity, tolerance, and world peace through the arts. 4 years later, the group has grown by leaps and bounds. Since then, the group has written and performed more than 5 original shows and events, produced and recorded 2 original songs entitled We Can Change Our World and The Time Has Come. In January 2006, they hosted Jewish Israeli and Arab Israeli teens from Peace Child Israel during Peace Child's 10-day U.S. Cultural Exchange Tour. Most recently, they won the Gloucester County Human Relations Commission's Humanitarian Award and Best Music Video or Commercial at the Delaware Valley Film Fest for the music video of We Can Change Our World. While Cal has come a long way, Deb Chamberlain, Eileen Lucarini, and advisor Margie Glick have many goals for the future of Cal.
Well, right now we're going to try to become a nonprofit. That's a lengthy process, but we think we've grown that much that we want to have our own group, not dependent on anything, and become well known. And we're hoping to get into the Garden State Film Fest, which is a really big one. So we're doing a lot of different mediums.
I hope that Cal can reach other kids to also want to to reach out to other kids and inspire them to want the same things. Because after all, these kids are the future. And if we can't teach them how to reach out and respect other kids, to other kids now, what's going to happen when they're older and they're the ones running this country?
Well, I have a lot of goals. My goals mostly are to inspire this group of students, young people, to listen to their dreams, listen to their vision for the world, and actually take it seriously, and to really get that they can make something happen towards their dreams starting now.
Getting together a show is a long and tedious process. It begins with brainstorming, writing, editing, rehearsing, and then dress rehearsals. With all the work and events that Cal has done, everybody has a different favorite.
We did this meeting just with the group in January of this year, where we did an exercise called If You Really Knew Me. And even with all the great projects we've done out in the world, this one transformed the relationships in the group. And I loved hosting the Peace Child Israel delegation when we brought them over from Israel. I mean, it was kind of like the same experience, but with Arab and Jewish Israeli students from halfway around the world. And everybody suddenly got their eyes opened up to realize, oh, the world is a small place and we're all the same.
We went to this one trip in Trenton, and we were supposed to sing for the governor. And we all bonded, we started singing and stuff, and it was great because the audience really got into it.
My favorite thing Cal has done has to be the music video. It was an experience and I enjoyed it, and I had so much fun doing it.
The Cal Project is one of the most unique groups Township has to offer, not only because of its many events and shows.
Cal is different from other clubs. Well, in my perspective, it's the only group that's actually diverse.
That it's the kids wanting to do this. It's an organization where it's powered by the kids, and that's the most important thing. It's not adults trying to go out and make a difference. It's the kids, and the kids are the power, and the kids are the ones that are going to make a change, and they're going to empower the other kids, and that's what makes it so special.
Since its creation, the Cal Project has made great strides in its goals for tolerance and diversity. For more information on the Cal Project or to become a member, please visit www.thecalproject.com. This has been Erin Dunphy reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 12.
Here at WTHS, we take pride in a school system which runs smoothly and supports student life. But because the teachers and the Board of Education have not yet come to an agreement on their contract, student life at WTHS is beginning to get a little rough around the edges.
Currently, our union has indicated that we should work to the contract. And what that means is that if we work to a certain period of time in the day and that's it, if you don't volunteer for anything that you don't get paid for, these are some of the things that we're trying to say. Look, unless we're bargained with and unless we get what we feel is a just contract, we're going to withhold services that we normally do, for free.
Most people today in the labor movement don't want to get ugly and call a strike or do anything like that and play hardball. It's just people who want to sit down and negotiate and do so fairly. But no side wants to prolong the talks or not get anything accomplished. Got some people who are a little bit more aggressive than others.
About every 4 years, the teachers and the Board of Education meet to negotiate the new contract. This past contract was up in June. And because there hasn't been a formal agreement yet, the teachers are currently working on an extended contract.
They're still under contract. Their contract that expired is just extended now, and they have all the rights and benefits of the contract they approved 3 years ago.
But don't think that the teachers and the Board of Education are the only two groups involved in the slow-moving negotiations process. Both teachers and students agree that student life here at WTHS is also being affected in a multitude of ways.
Unfortunately, it seems like the kids are affected the most, because I really think the kids get more of an experience out of having the faculty there as chaperones as opposed to the administration.
I mean, there are administrators that you've had in your elementary, middle schools, but I think you want your teachers that have been with you all 4 years. We need the support of our staff. Could we do it without it? Yes. Do I want to? No.
They are hurting the student life at Washington High School since they cannot volunteer or do any of the extra stuff. Specifically, Monzo or Powderpuff, where Monzo would help us out with charities and such. It's a shame because it's not for us. I mean, it's for ALS.
Student-teacher relationships are a valuable asset to any school. Teachers and students alike are feeling that Township is empty lately, with a drop in morale and a feeling that something just isn't right.
It's like frustrating, and there's this air in the school that, it's just like mundane, and people are just frustrated and upset, and you can tell. And
we're all feeling the effect. because you don't know who's supporting you, who's not supporting you. The emotions are very high.
As Martin Luther King Jr. once said, peace is not merely a distant goal which we seek, but a means by which we arrive at that goal. No matter what their view on the negotiations may be, everyone in the school district hopes that these two entities will come to an agreement soon. Till then, this has been Sam Baranowski reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 12.
That's all we have for this month, Township.
So tune in next month.
And every month, I'm Olivia Devine.
And I'm Sam Baranowski.
See ya.
All right. Is it recording?
Yeah.
All right. I don't want.
Serious, everyone. Go.
LOL, guys.
I hate him. He's not my friend. But back up. I like you. I'm just kidding.
This
Matt.
Look at her. You'll never keep a straight face.
Why?
Hey.
Uh-oh.
Volare. Hey, yo, you know, it feels great coming out, conference champions. We're doing our thing out there. We're the best. Bottom line. Period. Next question.
Ready?
Yeah, go. You can do it slowly. We can just speed it up.
That was just the beginning of their hectic prep. I said no cookies. Brr.
Mom, what are you doing? Mom, what are you doing, Mom?
This season, the boys have gone on a
IDK, my BFF Rose. Hi.
Oh, watch your head.
I am a Biebs. Can I stop now?